this morning. We're going to be doing service a little bit different this morning, so we got a little left and right thing. So we're going to start off the set with just one worship tune, and then we're going to move on into our service. We're just glad that you're here to worship with us. So come on, let's stand up together and let's sing.
Yeah.
Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this time of worship. And as we say time of worship, we mean the entire service. So I pray that you just put your presence into this building right now. We ask you just to come and take over. This is all for the glory of you. We are teaching on repentance today. And that's a hard subject sometimes. Sometimes our pride will get in the way of that. So, Father, we just invite you into this place. We ask that you fill this room, that you fill our hearts, that we can just overflow in your abundance of love and kindness and generosity in the things that you offer. So, Father, this service is for you. So have your way with it. We love you in your holy name.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to ACC. My name is Jen Hill. I'm the Life Group Director here, and I am so glad to see each and every one of you. So before you sit down, let's just take a moment to greet those around us with a handshake, high five, or hug. At ACC, we like to be really friendly because we are community, right? Good to see our Argyle people, our Flower Mound people, our Northlake people. Maybe say hi to someone you don't know. That would be crazy. All right. Well, as you are taking your seat, I know each week we have lots of visitors, and you probably went by the welcome table, but if you didn't, if you're visiting us for the first or second time, if you would just raise your hand, our ushers have just a quick form for you to fill out and a gift. So just keep your hand raised until they can get to you. Thank you so much. Okay, well, listen, we have a lot going on at ACC. Primarily, this week, it's all for students, so I'm going to direct my attention over here. So, guys, today, or this evening, I should say, at 6 o'clock is your second Hot Topic. So it's going to be the same time and place as Lyft, but Hot Topic is an opportunity for you to come together to discuss really tough but necessary topics that are going to really impact your life. So this week, our very own worship director, Chet Stevens, is going to be talking to you all about alcohol use, primarily the difference between a biblical view and a worldview. So students, you're not going to want to miss Hot Topic tonight at 6 o'clock. Also, any high school seniors in here? Whoop, whoop. This is quite the season for you and your parents. We are going to be recognizing all of our seniors on May 5th. And so make sure to mark your calendar, invite your friends and family. But most importantly, make sure to register for that so we can get your name up there. So you can do all of that by going to the ACC app and clicking the student button. In fact, if you don't have the ACC app, I highly recommend that you get it because that is where you can sign up for all the things and see our calendar. All right, I'd like to introduce Tim Bach here with Shelby Reed. Here we go.
All right. Boy, y'all look good today. Give yourselves a hand for that. You look amazing. You do. We're going to receive God's tithes and offerings, and you're probably wondering about the songs because we just did one, but we actually are going to come back today and worship, and Pastor Greg will explain why at the end of the message today. But how many of you ever seen this? Any parents know what this is? Kid cash. So when you get different ways that you can earn kid cash in our children's ministry. But one of the neatest things for me is that at the end, the kids get to give. And even though they don't have necessarily access to all the resources, they do have kid cash. And it's the most beautiful thing to watch a child look at that and think, I could buy something at the store, I could get candy, or they give them an opportunity to return to God some of their kid cash. Isn't that cool? And they're learning to be disciplined and learning to be generous. And I just thought it was kind of fun to remind us today. I love seeing that discipline in our church. I love seeing us surrender to God what is already His. Amen. And so today, if you want to do that and be a part of that, you can set up the giving, argylecommunitychurch.com. You can text any dollar amount to 84321. There's an offering box at the back. Or you can go to the app on the App Store and give in any way. We haven't had to pass an offering basket, and God has blessed this church and taken care of it. Amen. That's what He's done. It's His resource. This is Shelby. She's pretty amazing. She's going to be graduating this year. Give Shelby a hand. She is incredible, and we love her very, very much. She's going to pray to receive God's tithes and offerings today.
Please bow your heads with me. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning asking for your blessing and grace as we are gathered together. Thank you for everyone in this room and having them here this beautiful morning. I pray for the offering of our church that you will allow it to be used for your glory and to help us grow as a community. Thank you for this church and these people. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you, Shelby. So this morning, we wanted to sing. We're kind of on a theme today of repentance and mercy, and I hope it'll minister to you. I didn't want to be the singing preacher, but once in a while, all right? You okay with that? When I was just a child, I heard the Savior leading. I was drawn to what I could not understand. And for the cause of Christ, I spent my days believing that what he'd have me be is who I am. But now I've come to see the weaker side of me, and I realize his grace is what I need. And when sin demanded justice for my soul,
mercy said, "Oh, I'm not gonna let you go. I'm not gonna let you slip away. You don't have to be afraid." Mercy said no. Sin will never take control. In life and death stood face to face. Darkness tried to steal my heart away. Thank you, Jesus. The mercy said no.
Amen. Pastor Greg is taking this next message on repentance. I hope it ministers to your heart. God's mercy triumphs over judgment.
How are y'all doing today? Y'all doing good? Goodness gracious, dead crowd. I said, good morning. Goodness gracious. I first want to tell y'all, thank you so much. Y'all started my morning off great. So many compliments in the lobby. Walked up in there, a few of you were saying, Greg, you look great this week. I said, thank you. Then somebody said, man, Greg, you look professional this week. I said, man, thank you again. And somebody said, man, Greg, you look handsome this week. I said, thank you. What do y'all think I look like the rest of the time? Don't answer that. But I am thankful for the compliments. I will tell you this. So we are in a series right now, and it's in Matthew. That's the series. That's what it's called. And today what we're going to talk about is repentance. By a show of hands, how many of you have heard the word repentance? Raise your hand. We're going to discuss today specifically the command of repentance opposed to the suggestion of repentance. And the difference of the two and the outcome of the two. Are y'all cool with that? So my hope is that by the time we leave here, we'll have a different and a better understanding of what repentance is and why we should repent. I was 16 years old when I was heading home from an event at Northwest High School. I was heading home and I was just started driving and I'm coming up on this curve. My dad's here today. He's going to be able to attest to this. Story, I'm coming up on this curve. I'm going about 4 miles an hour. All of a sudden, the car gets out of control, and I wind up in a ditch. Oh, it's right. I'm sitting there in the ditch, and I'm thinking to myself, what am I going to do? So I called my dad. I said, hey, Dad, I'm in a ditch. He was like, by yourself? I was like, well, the car's with me. We are in a ditch. He said, okay, I'm going to come out. I'm going to help you. I'm going to take care of you. We'll see what's going on. He shows up to it. We look at the car in the ditch. He said, tell me what happened. I said, man, I was going about 3 miles an hour driving down this road. All of a sudden, this curve came up, and next thing I know, I'm in a ditch. He said, 3 miles an hour. I said, maybe five. I don't know, maybe five. He said, let's go take it to the auto mechanic shop. So we took it to the auto mechanic shop. He goes, Greg, I want you to tell them what happened. I said, all right. I was coming up on this curve, y'all. 3 miles an hour. Curve comes up. Next thing I know, I'm in a ditch. They said, you bent the control arm. You bent the frame. You bent the axle off of 3 miles an hour. I said, maybe five. I don't know. They all started laughing at me. They said, well, we can take care of it. We can take care of it. But here's what it's going to cost. So my dad said, hey, step outside with me for a quick second. So we stepped outside. I saw my dad's face, and the Holy Spirit said, man, Greg, you need to handle this differently. Mainly, the Holy Spirit said that's because I had no money to fix my car, okay? It's crazy how you are quick to repent when you have no money, you're broke. So I told my dad, man, here's what happened. I was going about 20 miles an hour up on this curve. I wasn't paying attention. I spun out, and I ended up in the ditch. And he said to me, he goes, Greg, I knew the entire time that is exactly what happened. I was just waiting for you to be transparent with me so we could handle it together. That's what he told me. And here's what I've come to the conclusion of, is secrecy is the steroid to sin, while repentance to God is his kryptonite. And so what we're going to talk about today is repentance. And I know there may be some people in here that has some dealing with something that they don't think anybody knows about. The problem is God knows. God knows, and he's waiting for us to be repentful from that. And so we're going to be in the book of Matthew, Matthew chapter 3. So if you have your Bibles, bring those. Students, do you have them? Bring them out. Matthew chapter 3. We're going to be in chapter 3, verses 1 through 11. And we're going to dissect this passage to really identify what is John the Baptist really saying here. So in verse number 1, y'all read with me. He says, in those days, John the Baptist came preaching in the wilderness of Judea. Now, one of the things that I love to share with the students is if it's in the Bible, it's meant to be there. And so you might read this verse and think, well, what does this really mean? Is this a big deal? I want to focus on the word wilderness. It's a big deal. Why is the wilderness important? So we're going to go ahead and talk about a few points of why the wilderness is important. Point number one is it's away from the norm. It's away from the norm. It's empty. It's where we can be taught and developed, where we can grow if we are humble, and it's a place that reveals what we trust the most. How many of y'all have ever been in a season where you're like, nothing is going right, and God has just stripped everything away from you because he's trying to identify, do you trust in me? Do you trust in me? That's the question that he has. And I will tell you that that's his number one goal, is full dependence of him. So the wilderness is really important here. Why John the Baptist went out was preaching in the wilderness. And here's what he was preaching. Here's the message. Repent because the kingdom of heaven is near. Now, I'm going to talk about repent here in just a little bit, but I want to highlight and focus on because the kingdom of heaven is near. We see this in other places in the Bible. Do we not? And I'm going to go ahead and show you exactly a few places that we see it. Daniel chapter 2, verses 44. It says, in those days of those kings, the God of the heavens will set up a kingdom that will never be destroyed. And this kingdom will not be left to another people. It will crush all these kingdoms and bring them to an end, but will itself endure forever. Forever. This is Daniel sharing his interpretation of the dream that King Nebuchadnezzar had. And so at this case in point, when he's sharing this, these people are thinking there's going to be a physical kingdom that is going to come. There's going to be a physical kingdom because that's all they've known is big buildings, big kingdoms that reign and that rule. But what Daniel's actually saying is not only will King Nebuchadnezzar's kingdom not reign, he's actually saying there's a kingdom even greater than that. That he's going to be talking about here in just a little bit. We also see it in Matthew chapter 4, verse 17, where Jesus says, from then on, Jesus began to preach, repent, because the kingdom of heaven is near. I showed you something in the Old Testament and in the New Testament on purpose, because I want you to look at this. There are over 63,000 cross-references within the Bible. I love teaching the students that because it's not just in one place. The Bible will always point back to itself. It will never point outside of itself. It will never say, hey, here's another reliable source for truth. Check X, Y, and Z. It would always point back within itself. I love this because it still remains to be consistent. And it also just shows the beauty that how it was written. When you understand that and you see that, it just comes alive in a way that just reading it face value doesn't bring. So cross-referencing is really important. So it says repent because the kingdom of heaven is near. I want to talk about repent. Now we're going to kind of segue into repentance, what it is, what it's not, and why we should repent, because he's clearly calling us to do that. Repent in the Cambridge version. If you look in your dictionary, here's what it says. To be sorry you did or did not do something. Just to be sorry that you did or you did not do something. But it's much deeper than that. Repent is actually from the Greek word metanoia. And it's two words put together. Meta means after, behind, beyond, among, or changed. Noia is to perceive or think. So if you put those two words together and you put those definitions of what he's really saying, here's what he's saying. I need you to change your minds. That's what he's saying. I need you to think differently than what you were thinking about. Now, repent from what? We'll discuss that here in a second. But nonetheless, we have an understanding of what repent is. Yes, everybody got that? So repent means to what? Change your minds. 100%. So we got that down. Because here's what I want you to understand is this. True repentance starts in our hearts, then leads to our minds, which then shows up in our hands and feet, not just our lips. So I want you to remember that. Repentance is not about a verbal confirmation, like a saying like, hey, I repent. Repentance is a changing of the mind. It's a changing of the heart. It's a changing of how we perceive what he's calling us to repent from, which we'll talk about here in a second. I will tell you this. I have a hard time thinking differently sometimes. Anybody else in here? My wife reminds me of this daily. She always says, Greg, if you would just listen to me, life would be so much easier. Any other husbands hear that? Golly. So I'll tell you this. Here's what happened. We're going to Living Spaces off of North Tarrant in Fort Worth. We're going up to Living Spaces. I see Living Spaces. We come in from this exit, and I'm like, this, she's like, why'd you turn here? I said, because this road's gonna lead up to Living Spaces. I know it's going to. She goes, Greg, it's not gonna connect. I said, it's gonna connect. She goes, Greg, there's a sign that says go this way. I said, I don't care what that sign says. We're gonna go. Because I know we're to take this car to get us where we need to go. And here's what happened. Take a look at
Honey,
this.
Honey, what do you have to say?
I'm sure it will at some point, but this is the second time this has happened today.
So what should I do?
Listen to me. Your life will be easy.
I gotta know, man. Are there any other husbands out there that go through this where their wife thinks they know better than anything?
But it's not, I think. Like, I am right. Like, more often than not.
Yeah.
There's also a giant sign that says entrance. Like, I'm just more, I pay attention.
At least I keep my seatbelt on. I drive safe.
Well, I thought we were getting out because I thought it was connecting.
Any other husbands deal with this? Anybody? Goodness gracious. My mind was made up. And even when I knew for a fact that I could not get to the destination, I still had in my mind, they got to connect somehow. But that didn't happen. That didn't happen. So I need to change my mind. So here's what I wanted to tell you about repentance. I'm going to show you three slides that we must pay attention to. Pride and repentance cannot coexist. So, pride and repentance cannot coexist. Number two, secrets and repentance cannot coexist. So we're talking about true repentance here. We cannot have pride. If you look throughout scripture, there's number one thing that God hates is pride. He says, I must have a humble servant that comes before me and acknowledges what I already know, but I need him to acknowledge it so we can handle it in a way that's fulfilling for him and my glory and their good. Number three is control and repentance cannot coexist. I don't know about you, but I struggle with some of these. I struggle with control. I struggle with wanting to have it my own way, clearly from the video, but even outside of that, that I want to do things my own way. But if I want to be somebody that's repentful, I can't have control. Can't have it. So let's go ahead and go into verse number three here. He says, for he is the one spoken of through the prophet Isaiah, who said a voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. So in Isaiah, I think it's chapter 40, verse 2 or verse 3, this is where this is said. So God's people are wandering. Take a guess where they're wandering at. Wilderness. And they're trying to identify, where do we go? Where do we depend on? What do we do? And this still remains the same. God's people needed to rely on God for his provision and for what he could provide for them, and is no different than here today. And he's saying, prepare the way of the Lord, make his paths straight. Verse number four says, now John had a camel hair garment with a leather belt around his waist, and his food was locusts and wild honey. Now I highlighted this because you might read like, well, man, maybe that's just his diet. I don't know. I would never eat it. But I will tell you this. You are what you eat. You are what you eat. Now, last time I was very transparent with y'all about what I love. Anybody remember what I love? Lemon bars. I love these things. They made me really big at one point, which I talked about. But the reason why I say you are what you eat, and I love lemon bars, is because of this. So when you think about what John, why did he eat that here? Today, currently, in the Middle East, in the wilderness, there are people that still eat those various things. They're lower income, they're poverty. So this actually is a showing of his humbleness and his humility and his desire to connect with those that were lower than him. Does that make sense? So he could have had a wide variety of things, but he chose that in the wilderness to connect with people that he couldn't connect with otherwise. So I think it's a really telling sign of who John the Baptist was and his heart for people. Not just a certain amount of people, all people. So he's asking us to repent, right? He's saying to repent. The kingdom of heaven is here. We'll repent about what? What do we need to change our minds about? Let's go ahead and take a look here. It's verse number five. And this is really going to segue us into what we should be doing today. He says, then people from Jerusalem, all of Judea, and all the vicinity of the Jordan were going out to him, and they were baptized by him in the Jordan River. Doing what? Confessing their sins. So that's the message today. He's saying, I need you to repent. I need you to change your mind. I need you to change your perspective about what? Our sin. And I want you to notice here, confessing our sins. I want to share this with you. I was talking to my wife about this last night on the way home from an event. I said, there's a very big difference between us coming before Christ broken, confessing our sin, than him bringing it to us. Big difference. And so he's waiting for us to have a humble, broken heart and understanding of who he is, what he's done, and the sin, the detriment that that has caused our relationship, our fellowship with him, and to come before him and confess our sin, opposed to being rebellious, acting like we don't have that, and he brings it in front of you and says, you've had this the entire time. So we must understand confessing our sins is still what we should do. No different than he told the people that were wandering in the wilderness. No different than John the Baptist is telling the people that are coming out in the wilderness here today. He said, confess your sins. It's a big deal. Sin always overpromises. I want you to pay attention to this because this is big. Sin always overpromises and underdelivers and leaves us more broken than ever before. This next statement is probably the most powerful statement. One of the most powerful statements I've ever heard. I come to FCA on Fridays because the students do FCA here on Friday. There is this student by the name of Jude who ran this meeting, and he said this, and it was so impactful. It says, if it breaks your Creator's heart, it will never satisfy yours. When I heard that, I was like, it's like I've known that, but for him to frame it that way and to say it that way and make that the mark and say, hey, if it breaks your Creator's heart, it is never going to satisfy yours. And what breaks his heart needs repentance. This is really the bulk of the message, my friends, right here today, is if you are struggling with something, if it's outside of God's design for you, if it's outside of his word, I'm telling you ahead of time, I'm giving you a cheat code, it will never fulfill you, ever. But God is so gracious and so good, he says, man, but I can still restore if you come to me with a broken heart and repent from your sins. Verse number 7 says, when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees coming to his baptism, he said to them, broad vipers, who warned you to flee from the coming wrath? Now we see Pharisees and Sadducees in scriptures all the time, but I want to be very clear about who they are and who they are not. They actually didn't like each other. They were at odds. They didn't like each other. They liked certain things and similarities, which we'll talk about, but the Pharisees were very religious. They had high standards, they focused on the law, and they actually developed a system of rules that went beyond the inspired law of Moses for their benefit, because it was all about them. The Sadducees were very religious as well, extremely wealthy. They actually cooperated with Rome's the occupation, and they were resented by the people. So they worked with the government to make it all about them. But here's what they were both similar on. They were self-centered. They cared more for religion over relationship. They wanted to protect their power. That's what they wanted. They thought very highly of themselves. And here's the other thing is, they had their minds made up. They weren't going to change their minds. They had their minds made up. It didn't matter if the Son of God was right in front of them, which he was. They were not going to think any different of them. You see, religion gives a rating, while repentance of sin deepens the only thing that matters, our relationship with Jesus. So we can sit here and come before Jesus and tell people, like, hey, man, here's how many times I come to church. Here's how many times I do this. And that's what the Pharisees and the Sadducees did. They wanted a rating. They wanted a five-star rating. And Jesus is like, man, I don't care about that. You don't have a five-star rating without me. I actually need you. You actually have nothing without me. And the only thing that really matters is my relationship with you. And that still remains present today. Verse number 8 says, therefore, produce fruit consistent with repentance. So he's telling these people, he said, hey, listen, I know you're coming out here and you're very religious. Totally get that. But the fruit is not what I'm looking for. You don't have a repentful heart. You don't. And here's why. Here's why. True change must occur when we repent, which means true belief must take place because behavior always follows belief. So it's not a matter of us trying harder. I'm telling you, we're not going to be more perfect than the Sadducees were. I mean, they were the cream of the crop, and they killed Jesus, right? So we're not going to be better morally than them in any shape, form, or fashion. It's not going to happen. And Jesus is telling them, John the Baptist is telling them, you're missing the mark. So I want you to understand here today, if we have a behavior problem, it's because we have a belief problem. That's the problem. So it's not a matter of modifying the behavior and thinking the belief will come. It will never come. If you have the belief, the behavior is soon to follow because you truly understand and believe what we should. And the outcome of that is what God can only give us. Does that make sense? And so it remains true then. It remains true now. Let's go ahead and read verse number 9. Here's what their excuse was. Actually, John the Baptist knew this, and here's what he said to them. He said, "And don't presume to say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our father.' For I tell you that God is able to raise up children from Abraham from these stones. The axe is already at the root of the trees. Therefore, every tree that doesn't produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire." Their default was their lineage. They said, "Hey, we have Abraham as our father, so we're good. We ain't got to do all that." Now, you might read that, and I love to pull application, real application that we can utilize because Scripture is alive and it's active. We just got to sit here and pull that. So I will tell you this. Here is what this may sound like today. Well, I was raised in the church. I heard people say that. I was raised in the church. Or say, my parents are Christians. That's basically what they said, that my parents were God's people. And I'm here to tell you this. Our dependence is not on a lineage. It's on a relationship, an individual choice that we choose to have in Jesus. It's that plain and simple. So all these other things that they said didn't work, and they don't work now. I've read the Bible from front to back. I hear people say that sometimes. I've read the Bible front to back. I'm like, all right. I don't know what to say. It sounds good. Are we living that, though? I'm a good person. We have Christian traditions. We pray before we eat. I wear a cross on my necklace. All these things. How many of y'all have heard these, right? We've heard them, and we think that equates to an eternity with Christ, and that's just not the case at all. So these Sadducees and Pharisees were defaulting, saying, "Hey, our fathers, our people, our family, they were Christians, so we're good." And he's saying, "No, that is not the case at all. That is not exactly what I'm looking for." And here's why I think they had an issue with this, and I think we do as well. It's because we do not mind hearing a message. We don't mind. We'll come in every Sunday morning. We'll hear the message. We'll listen to it. But give us information. Don't ask for me to change. That's what we really want. We want to come in here and say, "Hey, I actually want to come in as I am, and I want to leave as I am, but I want the benefits of the rock." That's what I want. And that would never happen. So we can't sit here and say, "Hey, just give me information, I'll be good." Because the Sadducees and Pharisees were okay with that. It was the changing of the mind that he was asking them to have. When he was saying repent, he was saying, "I need you to repent and change your mind and your perspective of how you think the kingdom is, because he's coming. And you need to understand that it's not a physical kingdom. It's the Son of God that is coming, and you need to put your faith in him. So give us information, but ask for us to transform." That's what we want, and that's what we should desire. We should not just talk the talk, but we should walk the walk. We've all heard this, right? But I think that we have a problem with this. I have a problem with this. Is I'm preaching this today, and I will go home, and I will still have the desires to do the things that my flesh wants at times, respond in certain ways, but the truth remains the same. We have twin girls, Savannah and Prescott. We are in the journey now of trying new things with them, all sorts of things. Soccer has been what we've been trying to do. So we tell Savannah Prescott, "We are going to play soccer." "Yeah, yeah, Daddy, we're ready." "Okay." I'm like, "Good. Kick the ball in the goal." This is on the way to the game. "We're ready." "Everything's great." "Yes, I'm ready, Dad." "You're a soccer player." "I'm a soccer player." "Our family's a soccer player. We are going to go play soccer," right? We go out there. I don't even want to click the next slide, but I'm going to show you. This is my daughter playing soccer. So
Alicia, that's her playing soccer. Field this week. Well, her team scored. Prescott, your team just scored. Are you excited?
So that's her playing soccer. She enjoys it. She likes it. I had somebody ask me yesterday, they said, "Hey, can you go to this event in the morning?" I said, "No, I got to go watch my daughter play soccer." And what I mean by that is she's going to stand on the field while everybody else play soccer. But that's what I said. And so that was that day. Later on that night, we were hanging out with some friends. They said, "Hey, what did you do today, Prescott?" She said, "I played soccer." I said, "Honey, you didn't play soccer." But she thinks I played soccer. That's what she's saying. And it was such a great reminder about true discipleship. Because the Pharisees and the Sadducees came out there. They said, "Hey, we're followers of all the things." But they didn't walk. They talked the talk. They didn't walk the walk. That's not who they really were. We love discipleship here at ACC. It's everything that Jesus cares about. Understand this. True discipleship, yes, is taught, but it's better taught when caught because our lifestyle reflects the teaching. Pay attention to that. So we can't be a church that just talks about discipleship. We must be disciples that live that out and follow Jesus. I'll tell the students this. I'm very frank with them. I tell them, the hardest thing about following Jesus is following Jesus. It's the hardest thing to do. But the reality of it is everything else outside of it is worse. It's hard. And there's no fulfillment. So we must, yes, share discipleship, but we must have a lifestyle that reflects the teaching. Verse number 11 says, "I baptize you with water for repentance, but the one who is coming after me is more powerful than I. I am not worthy to remove his sandals. He himself will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire." He also says this, "He must increase, but I must decrease." He says this in John chapter 3, verse 30. And in 2 Chronicles 7, 14, here's what he says, "If my people who bear my name would humble themselves, pray and seek my face and turn from their evil ways, then I will hear from heaven, forgive their sin, and heal their land." It's consistent. One of the things I love sharing with the students is this. If we were tonight at Lyft, I would highlight the word "then." And I would tell them, that's a contingental statement. And I'd ask them, you know what I mean by contingency? So if I read it like this, if we want to hear from heaven, have our sins forgiven, and heal our land, then we must what? Humble ourselves, pray, and seek my face and turn away from their evil ways. But what we do oftentimes is, hey, I want all that, but I don't want to do the other. And it will never work. So then is so important because that's our job. That's what we need to sit here and do. And we need to sit here and come before him and humble ourselves and pray and seek him. You see, repentance of our sin reflects a humility that pleases God, that then creates an intimacy with him that acting self-righteous never, ever, ever brings. So it's extremely important that we repent because the kingdom of heaven is near. It was then, it's coming back. He's coming back, y'all. I was talking to Nathaniel early this morning and when him and I were just studying. So here's five. Right now, people are like, "Well, it's the end of times." Listen, I that's to be determined. But there are a few things that I know, and I shared this with Nathaniel. One thing I know is that Jesus is the only way. John 14, 6 says, he's the way, the truth, and life. He's the only way. I also know that there's those around me that don't know that, that have no idea that he is the only way, that he is the truth. I also know that in 2 Corinthians, he says, you are ambassadors to share the gospel with them. That's what you should do. I also know that the only thing that we can take to heaven is people by sharing that with them. And the fifth thing I know is he's coming back. I don't know when, but those five things, mark them down. They're happening. And so this message that he shared in the wilderness to these people is the same message that I have for you today, is repent because the kingdom of heaven is near. I want to conclude before we go into a time of worship. This is Chanson. I'm going to tell you, man, I love all the students. I love what God's doing in this kid's life. About 2 months ago, he came to me and just started talking to me and just sharing what God has done in his heart. He started a Bible study up here at the high school. He's on fire. This is a picture of him at Gather, which is our high school worship night that we had, where we all came together and we worshiped. I took a picture of that. I showed it to him after, and I just showed him how proud of him I was. Because this, to me, is worship, repentance, glory, all wrapped in one picture. And I'm just so thankful for him and his acknowledgement of repentance and the importance of that. So right now it's 10:45. You might be thinking, are we getting out early? No, no. I can go for 15 more minutes. But the reason why I asked, I wanted the worship side, the singing side, to come on the backside of the service today is because worship is a response. That's what it is. It's a response of a heavenly Father and what he's done. Let me tell you this, man. God is good. Would you agree? Amen? Is he not? He's really good. I also tell you this. If Jesus didn't, God didn't do anything else for you, he's still worthy to be praised. So I wanted to take the time as a church, because here's the deal. At the beginning of the service, at 10 o'clock, announcements are important because we got a lot of great things going on. Preach is important, but I don't think there's anything more cool than a body of believers coming together and worshiping in unison to a Heavenly Father. I don't think there is. And I think sometimes we miss that. And so I wanted us to do that today because here's the thing. We all need repentance. All of us are dealing with something. Some of us may have an addiction that nobody knows about. Some of us may have an addiction that people are aware about. Some of us may have control problems. Students, you may have a problem honoring your father and mother. Parents, you may have a hard time being patient with your kids. You might have a dislike or maybe a disdain for somebody in this room that's supposed to be a brother and sister in Christ. Whatever it may be, we have all something to repent about. And so I would like for us to stand at this time. Tim will conclude us at the end, but I want to spend time just worshiping together as we worship our Lord and Savior.
That's why I trust in. I sought the Lord. Much deeper within through the
I'm sorry, Lord, for the things I've made it. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus.
Would you do this for me? Chet, would you stay with me for a second, bud? Just want you to play that through one time. Just all the ladies, if you would. All the ladies in this room, just sing it with a full voice. Ready? I'm coming back to the heart of worship.
I'm coming back to the heart.
You sing it. Sing it out. Yeah. I'm sorry. Men's study on a Tuesday. I thought, these guys are never going to sing. This gentleman Johnny comes and he leads worship for us, and all those members sing with a full voice. I was amazed. So I'm going to ask these guys to be courageous today. Would you do this with me? All the men, just sing that through one time. You can do it. You ready? I'm coming back to the heart of worship.
It's all about you.
All about you.
It's all about you, Jesus.
Sorry, Lord.
I'm sorry, Lord.
When it's all about you, Jesus. I'm going to ask you to do something courageous. Would you bow your heads and just lift your hands in the air? I'm going to ask every man, woman, boy, and girl in this room to sing it with a loud voice. I think it's the best way we could close the day. And mean it from your heart. I'm coming back. Ready? Let's sing.
Says I'm coming back to the heart of worship.
It's all about.
It's all about.
It's not about us, God. It's all about you.
It's all about you.
I'm sorry, Lord.
I'm sorry, Lord, for the things I've made.
When it's all about.
It's all about. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm coming back to the heart of worship.
Make this our prayer today. It's all about you.
It's all about you.
It's all about you.
It's all about you.
I'm sorry, Lord.
I'm sorry, Lord, for the things I've
made it. But it's all about you. It's all about you. Second, you know, in discipleship, when we talk about repentance, we talk about changing our minds. As Greg said, it starts, we have to believe different for our behavior to follow. The way Pastor Ron that wrote that material says it, he says that confession is agreeing with God about sin. A lot of times he's waiting for us like a child to say, I agree with you, I know what I did, I know what I'm doing, I know that this is wrong. Listen, don't live in guilt and condemnation, but today God is calling us to let him renew our minds so that our behavior will follow. So I just want to ask for our prayer partners to go to the left and right today. What I want you to do is they move and they get in place. At the end of this service, they're there to pray with you for anything that you could be walking through. But I want to ask you, with every head bowed and eye closed today, to think about what is a specific struggle with sin. What is something that God is asking of you to agree with him, to give this to him, to give it up and let him cleanse you? And if you don't think you can be set free, you need to know that the mercy of God is bigger than your sin. And it's bigger than that struggle. And he can set you free and have this behind you forever. Today we'll stand with you. We'll pray. We'll believe with you that God will do just that. So as this service is dismissed today, I'm going to ask Chet just to sing this again as you're dismissed. Just know that if you like prayer today, we're here to be around, to be with you. I'm thankful for the genuine movement of God that's happening at ACC. I believe that God's going to continue to make this place a generous place of worshipers that pour out our worship on him. Let's sing it again last time.
So I'm coming back to the heart of
it's all about you. Oh, it's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the things I made. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus.
God bless you guys. You can be dismissed today. Thank you for coming.
When it's all about you.